not obesity, they're not physical activity, they're not smoking, they're not cholesterol levels. They're the non-medical and non-behavioral aspects of life, which I'll give you in a second, or society, that shape the health of individuals. And any given one of these are much more important than the issues that we're bombarded with. And social determinants of health just don't happen. They're basically about decisions that society, politicians, people, although I would argue people really don't have much influence as much as they used to, but they're basically about decisions about how much are we going to give people or allocate or distribute to resources in terms of economic and social security by virtue of their being citizens. And we all know that none of us are citizens anymore. We're all just taxpayers. And this shift in language, this shift in media messaging is all related to all of this. This is, I say to my students, of which some of them are here, this stuff has been kicking around since 1991. In 1991, Margaret Whitehead and Göran Dahlgren outlined a model that resonates incredibly well today. And that is ultimately health is a function of individual characteristics, but these individual characteristics are clearly embedded within the social and community in which we live and the public policies that affect our living and working conditions, whether they're housing, unemployment, healthcare services, education, work environment, and so forth. So again, the social determinants are basically the living and working conditions, but these themselves are embedded within broader issues, many of which are ultimately political. Now, we keep adding our list. These are our current list of social determinants of health. And race is interesting because it's heavily related to immigration. And there's a lot of discussion about, is it immigration status of people that are of color, or is it race itself? The long and the short of it is that the social determinants that are yellow are primarily about who we are and our identity. And as it turns out, these things have a profound determinant aspect to our health and well-being. And these other issues of early life, education, employment, and working conditions, any single one of these, any single one of them, whether it's food security or whether you're working or not, have infinitely more impact on your health than whether you're overweight, about whether you exercise or not, and even whether you smoke or not. But these issues are just not on the table. They're not involved in any kind of public discussion on an ongoing basis. Very briefly, these social determinants of health are profoundly important because, as a minimum, they're about your day-to-day living conditions, about whether you have the shelter, food, warmth, and the ability to participate in society. Closely related to it, correlated with it, but having its own independent role, is the fact that when people have, shall we say, not great social determinants of health, they also know that and they experience stress and anxiety. So when going to a food bank is not a benign experience. It's not like going to the zoo. You go to the food bank because you know you don't have food, you know that you're on the edge, and basically in terms of self-identity, if you're a mom or a dad, you know that in some form or another, society feels that you have failed in your role as parents. So stress, anxiety, and I'll show you some slides that suggest that half of Canadians say that they would be in difficulty if their paycheck was a week late. That's unbelievable when you think about it. And finally, it doesn't help to weigh 600 pounds. It doesn't help to smoke. It doesn't help to be sedentary. But all of these things are difficult enough for any of us to change, much less when you're experiencing these adverse social determinants of health. So experiencing adverse conditions certainly makes it more difficult to achieve these desirable changes in behavior. All of them come together and all of them lead to adverse health outcomes. Another aspect is that all of these cluster together So there are very few people who have wonderful high-paying jobs who live in slums. There's very few rich people who go down to food banks in order to save money to buy a new stereo receiver. And in the case of poverty, where we're looking at 13 to 15% of children in Ontario, all of these cluster together that people experience all of these things at the same time. And all of this adds up and produces profoundly adverse health outcomes. Now, social location is an interesting thing when I moved into sociology. Basically, it's about what we might call one's identity, gender, race, sexual orientation, ethnicity, class, but ultimately, they're about power and influence. And as I say to my students all the time, if you're a single mom and you call up Kathleen Wynne and say, you know, it'd be really great if you raise the minimum wage, then my kids would feel better about themselves. We wouldn't have to go to food banks. Is that going to get as much weight as the head of the Chamber of Commerce calling up Kathleen Wynne and saying, if you raise the minimum wage, you're going to be in trouble? So social location is about influence, power, and the ability to affect public policy. Now, one of my students who is here was talking about social inequality and came up with these wonderful pitches. And the interesting thing about making sense of the fact that particular groups experience adverse health, which we call health inequalities, is that it's just about everybody. If you happen to be an Aboriginal Canadian, or a single mom, or working class, or a female, or an immigrant, or a person of color, or someone with a disability, you're at risk for experiencing adverse social determinants of health. And in fact, as I'll show you about, it seems that everybody except middle-class white males seem to be at risk. And I think that tells you about the nature of society and the extent to which we seem to be managing these issues or not. So what can we say about Toronto? As I said, it'll depend on which slide we're looking at. This is the city of Toronto. And the latest data, as of 2006, and again, we have issues related to data, is that 22%, 23% are identified as being of low income. Now, the thing about low income is you can measure it in like very lots of different ways. There's the low income measure where you earn less than 50% of the average. There's a low income cutoff where you're spending more than 20% of the average Canadian on necessities. Research seems to indicate in Britain they develop four, five, six different ways. Some of them were highly statistical measures. And another thing was to say to people, being poor is not being able to do the kinds of things that most people think you should be able to do. Do you think you're poor? Well, it turns out that last question is as good as all the fancy statistical stuff. So no matter how you measure it, people know when they're poor, and the data indicates that you experience adverse health outcomes. And the scary thing is you don't just experience it as a child, whether it's asthma, school problems, injuries. Being poor as a child is a better predictor of whether you're going to get type 2 diabetes or have heart disease than all of these lifestyle behaviors. So you can see that in Toronto, 23% of all economic families are identified as being poor, 30% of Aboriginal, 31% of visible minority, 26% immigrant, and recent immigrants, the ones that they only let into the country if they're healthy and well-educated. And we're not just talking about, you know, well-educated, given a BA. These people are doctors, lawyers, everything. This group has a poverty rate of 40%. Work by Mike Orme, and I'm not spending a lot of time on this because Grace Edward will be here next week. Mike Orme at York Institute for Social Research looked at data which refers to the census metropolitan area. And as you can see, it's basically the city of Toronto and a lot of other areas where people commute. So the CMA is what Statistics Canada uses, and it's a pretty big area. Well, the first thing you see is that if you happen to be white, you got a 10% chance of being poor. Now, I say to my students, especially students who might be from Mexico or from Pakistan, Don't think that all white people in Toronto are doctors, lawyers. There's some really beat up white people in Toronto and in the CMA. But it seems that as long as you're white, you only have about a 10% chance of being poor. But if you're Aboriginal, it's 20. If you're Arab and West Asian, it's 30. South Asian, 20. East Asian, 20. Africans, which to my mind, at least the students that I see are well-educated, speak really good English. They actually read newspapers and follow current events. 40% of African immigrants in the CMA are living below the poverty line. And then, of course, we have the Caribbean and South Central Asia. If you look a bit more carefully at it, you can break it out by group. And you can see the Somali population over 70%, Afghan, Ethiopian, Bangladesh, and you can work your way down. It's just about every group has profoundly higher low income or poverty rates than all the European groups. This slide basically shows that it's getting worse. In 1970, if you happened to be a South Asian immigrant woman, you actually were making more than the average European born, or what does it say on the left? Income as a percent of average for European workers, so basically white. And what you can see is, and again, this was the Toronto I moved into in 1973, for whatever reason, immigrants were, women were more or less earning the same thing as compared to European descent. And then over time, it gets worse. And again, Grace Edward argues that this has a lot to do with the onset of neoliberal ideology, the government's pullback, and what it does is as life becomes more stressful and more competitive, it leads to latent racism, non-latent racism. It basically, as life becomes more difficult, certain groups begin to suffer. Now, you can see on the bottom, men, different immigrant group men, were actually doing worse than whites as early as 1970, and that has continued to decline. If you look at the poverty rate for the Arab, South Asian, East Asian, if you look at the poverty rate, well, okay, this does not have the poverty rate for European. They used as a comparison. But in comparison to this group, the situation has declined over time. Now, this isn't because Canada's economy has declined. Canada's never been richer. The economy's never been as large as it is. And this is the incidence of low income for global groups. And here's where I want to draw your attention to the second line, the black line with a circle, which is the European. You can see in 1970, the poverty rate in the Central Metropolitan Area for white people was 13, and by 2000, it had gone down to 10%. Those poverty rates are stable and they're low. But what you can see is for every other ethnic group, and of course, again, going back, South Asians actually had a lower poverty rate, as did Arab and West Asian. For every group until 2000, and we don't really know what's happened since then, the poverty rate has increased over time. Now, what about health? This is taken from a City of Toronto report in 2006 where they took city neighborhoods or census tracts and they separated them into the poorest 20%, the next poorest 20%, middle 20%, so forth, up to the top richest 20%. And this is fairly typical that any kind of child problem you want to take, you're basically going to see profound differences between income groups. Low birth weight is 4.5% in the richest 20% of Toronto neighborhoods, and it's 50% higher in the poorest. Lack of readiness to learn is at 20%. In the richest neighborhoods and 34% in the poorest. And teen pregnancy rates is 16% in the richest neighborhoods and over close to three times higher in the poorest neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. To To add another little overlay to this, abortion rates are also much higher in the richest neighborhoods. So if we were to actually look at kids' teenage births, the differences would be even greater, because the actual births would be much lower in the richest neighborhoods. Now, this applies to any affliction you ever want to think of, anything. Kids cracking their heads on sidewalks, being hit by cars, asthma, emergency room visits, anything, any conceivable measure of social health, physical health, or mental health, you're going to see the same thing over and over again. Now, what about how we try to make sense of this? Here is your diabetes map, and 90% of diabetes is the kind of diabetes you get when you get older. So this is not the kind of my 15-year-old kid doesn't have his pancreas working anymore. This is diabetes when you get older. And I'll just say that despite the view that we know exactly what causes diabetes, quote unquote, the mechanisms that lead to type 2 diabetes are poorly understood, which is from a journal article. It basically means we don't know what really causes it. But I'll suggest something. So the first thing you see is this kind of crescent where the diabetes rates are going through the roof in the northwest and kind of down there and going around. Well, when this came out, the first reaction was, oh, we got to get people out of their cars. Well, these people don't own cars. And the next thing was, oh, they're living too far away from the fruits and vegetable stores. Well, if you actually look at the data, that plays a role, but it plays a very small role. So what you have here is this immediate reaction, oh, get these people eating fruits and vegetables, get them walking, as if somehow that can explain all of it. Well, then another study comes along and you see the same pattern, and it's the same groups that have the high diabetes are also visible minorities. So this allows everybody to talk about genes. South Asians have bad genes. Chinese people have bad genes. Black people have bad genes. I said to a Toronto Star reporter, don't you think it's amazing that every single group except white Europeans have bad genes, bad lifestyles? So again, this opens up this genetic thing and the fact they're all adopting Canadian lifestyles. 20 years ago, the problem with South Asians, I was told, was they were eating their traditional diets, which as we all know are heavy. Have you just eaten it? Heavy, a little bit oily. And now 20 years later, oh no, that's not the problem. The problem is they're giving up their traditional diet and eating like Canadians. Well, what is it? Well, maybe it's this. The same map. It's a poverty map. Here, diabetes, visible minorities, poverty. Complete identical map. But wait, there's more. This is low birth weight. Blue is really high. Dark green is really low. The same map. Now, what do you think this map is? Besides being the same map, what do you think the pinpricks are? Same map. Guess what? This is from Stats Canada, distribution of crime, average income. In this case, low income is yellow and green. There's the crescent. Local violent crime rates, same map. And now to bring gender into the issue, local rates of sexual assaults, the same map. It's the same stuff. Now, what about the health of people? Very simply, if you look at the third, one, two, the fourth bar over, that is the standard. This is over time, how many people say that the health is deteriorated. So at one point in time, you ask them, what's your health? Excellent, very good, good, poor. Excellent, very good, fair, or poor. Then you come back 3, 4, 5 years later, and you say, how's your health? And you identify the percentage of people who went from excellent to very good. From good to fair, people that declined. Using as a baseline what the report is of long-term European immigrants, which is one, What you find is, actually, the baseline is Canadian-born population, the bottom one, the black one. Using that as a baseline, you find that reports from European immigrants, now again, I have to stare at this here, but I can't read that thing. Recent non-European immigrants is the first one. What you can see is that they're almost 2.5 times more likely to report deterioration in health over time as a Canadian-born population. The next line is long-term non-European immigrants, and they have 1.7, which is 70% greater risk. But look at recent European immigrants. They're even less likely than Canadian-born population to report a deterioration in health. And long-term European immigrants are more or less the same. So what you see is these non-European immigrants, in other words, immigrants of color, are coming to Canada, and over time, they're reporting a decline in health at a magnitude that's at least twice what it is for people that have been born here. Now again, the throwaway arguments is suddenly they're all eating at McDonald's. Suddenly all these people that were running around and active in Africa are suddenly sitting around watching TV. That's not an explanation. The explanation are the slides I showed you earlier. The stress, the incongruence between what they were told they were going to get in Canada and what they actually get. Now, in terms of the poverty map, in 1981, this is from the United Way, and in 1981, whatever you see there, the yellow, the amber or the brown, are neighborhoods that have higher poverty rates. And on the right, there's a key there. And you can see that as the economy has been growing and Canada's become wealthier and wealthier, the city is filled in to the point that by 2006, outside of Rosedale and the beaches and parts of Etobicoke, what you're basically seeing is a tremendous growth of poverty in the city of Toronto. From the hunger report, hunger count, from the Daily Bread Food Bank, there's been an 18% increase since the pre-recession period in people using food banks. The number of visits to GTA food banks is over 1 million. And you can see here, there's figures for 905, there's figures for Toronto. And certainly, by the time you make it to a food bank, and we know that only about 1 out of 4 people who have food insecurity issues actually go to a food bank. Related to what we've just said about immigrants, you can see that there's been a significant increase in the percentage of food bank users of people born outside of Canada. You can see that certainly having a university degree doesn't shield you from having to use a food bank. And again, we have the same picture again of something gone awry in the operation of our society. Now, the Toronto Vital Signs Report came out a couple of weeks ago, and there's differing definitions. Some of the slides are about the Greater Toronto Area. The ones that are fit, the shaded one is the Census Metropolitan Area. The other one is the GTA, but the picture is fairly straightforward. I just took this quote out. In Toronto, and again, I'm not sure exactly which Toronto they're referring to, City of Toronto, GTA, and Grace Edward would have a better feel for this. Almost 60% of low-income families are from racialized groups, although they account for just under half the population, which doesn't really line up with the next paragraph. Race, which is also from the same report, racialized Toronto residents are 2 to 4 times as likely to fall below the low-income cutoff as non-racialized residents. So maybe, and that's clearly consistent with the numbers I showed you from Michael Orne. This is work taken from David Holshansky, and it's really somewhat frightening. What David does is he uses as a baseline the entire Toronto census metropolitan areas, and he calculates that as the average. And then he says, compared to that average, what do different neighborhoods in the city of Toronto compare to them? And what you can see is that in 1970, compared to this broad Toronto picture, 2.1 of neighborhoods in Toronto were identified as being very low income. They were 46% below this general average. And you have to imagine me moving up here from New York in 1973. And boy, this is different. One of the first things when people say, what do you mean it's different? I said, poor people are more likely to be white. You know, I live near Regent Park, we were white. I mean, where I came from, if you were colored, you were poor, quote unquote. But look what's happened over time. Now by 2010, 14% of census tracts of neighborhoods are now identified as very poor. The next one, the low income, gone from 24% to 36%. 36% plus the 13, you got almost 50% of neighborhoods are going down. Middle income, 1970s, 60% of Toronto neighborhoods were